Okay, I want to talk to you about the graph of logarithms and exponential functions. We have four graphs in chapter four. We are in chapter four, exponents and logs. An exponential graph is of the form of some base raised to an exponent. Now, this base can be a number greater than one, and it will have this shape to it. It will be an increasing function, 1 through 0, 1. Or if it is a fraction base to an exponent, or a base to a negative exponent, these mean the same thing, it will be a decreasing function, still going through the pivotal point, 0, 1. A log function is the inverse of an exponential function. If you were to rewrite this as a log, that would be a log base 2 of y equals x, as it would be if we change this out, but we switch x and y's places because logs are inverse functions. So this is the expression of this in log form with x and y switched, the inverse function. So if we draw a line y equals x, this graph should reflect over that to show the inverse, if they're both still base 2s, just for this is an example. So instead of going through 0, 1, x and y switch places in an inverse, we should be going through 1, 0. Then the same thing for the fraction one. The log with a fraction base should be the inverse of this, 1 through 1, 0. And reflecting this one across y equals x, you should see this graph. Number 72 asks you to find f of x equals 4 to the negative x. Should look a lot like this graph. And you should memorize these four different shapes. They're all the same shape. They just flip different directions, really. And if you're in doubt which one it is, make a t-table. Say, I wonder if I plug in 1, where a point would be. You can always find specific points on the graph to verify your answer. But anyway, this should be of this type. And notice I've picked a few t-table values. I've plugged in 0 for x, 4 to the negative 0, or 4 to the 0 is 1. So 0, 1 is on this graph. I've plugged in 2, 4 to the negative 2 is 1 16th, or 0.06, just barely over 2, it's barely above the x-axis, very small. And then I've plugged in negative 1. 4 to the negative 1 is 4 to the first, or 4. So back 1 should be up 4, and then you can see that's why that graph looks that way. Okay, number 73 is also an application of this with the shifting rules. So this is greater than 1 base. So y equals, not a log function, so it's one of our exponential functions. Because it's greater than 1, it has the shape of this graph. It should be similar to the 2dx graph, or, you know, in general, just a base a, and the book would state in general terms, some base to the x. So this should be of this type with a shifting of positive 1 to the right. You know, if it's grouped on the x, it's the left-right shift, and you change its sign in groupings. We always change the sign to what would make it equal 0. So it's opposite of what you see. There's a positive 1 shift, and then that's a vertical shift of down 5. So if you think of the pivotal point as normally at 0, 1, then if we add 1 to the x value and subtract 5 from the y value, that would shift it and make it positive 1x, and 1 and negative 5 would be at negative 4. So you should see the point over 1, down 4 on your graph, and it'll look something like that. You may just be able to pick up from looking at your choices. The graph that looks like this moves over 1 and down 5 places. Now, as always, I prefer you find at least one real-time xy value from a t-table to verify you've got the right graph. So let's say you plug in, let's plug in 1. Well, I already know 1, but just to verify it. Plug in 1 for x, we have 3 to the 1 minus 1 minus 5. 3 to the 0, that would be minus 5. Your calculator can do this. That's 1 minus 5 or negative 4. Now we know over 1, down 4 should be on our choice graph we picked. Okay, then we're going to skip down a little bit. We'll talk about logs again, or about graphing again. So 74 is solving an exponential equation, which is exactly what we do with logarithms when we're trying to figure out the exponent. You are, in essence, doing a logarithm problem. But there's a way to get around this without a logarithm if we can get it to come out even. For example, if I say 5 to what power is 25, I don't need a calculator necessarily to help me with that. I know that x is 2. But the mathematical way to do that is make these like bases. Say that's 5 to the second. If you can make like bases out of your equation, then the exponents have to be equal. So that's why x is 2. So we're going to use that trick on a little more complicated problem here and try to make these bases look the same so we can solve the exponents. 256 just happens to be 4 to the 4th power. Oh, it's 1 over 4 to the 4th power. I need both of these to have the same base, so I'm seeing a 4 is emerging here, but this 1 over 4 won't do. I have to take it up so it's on the level, so it's not a fractional amount. So bring it up makes it 4 to the negative 4. You know, when you move something from the numerator to the denominator, vice versa, it changes the sign of the exponent on that base. So that's why it's negative 4. Now we have like bases. These exponents can be set equal. And now we can solve for x. Minus 5, minus 5, x negative 9. Divide out for 3, x is negative 3. And you can verify that that does work by plugging it back into the original equation. We're going to try that again on 75. There's a way to make these like bases again. I see a 3 as a possibility. I know 9 is 3 squared, and this 1/3 could be flipped to make that a 3, but it makes a negative 1 exponent in front of that binomial exponent that's already there. 9 is 3 squared. Bring down its binomial exponent as well. Remember, those need parentheses because there's more than one part. Now that these are like bases, these exponents can be set equal. We're able to solve this equation. Distribute, get your x's together, your constants together, divide by what's with your variable, x is 4/5. Again, you check that on your calculator to be sure. Okay, the next couple of problems we're going to work have to do with a formula for compound interest. We have two compound interest formulas, actually, that we use in this chapter. We have A equals P, and you do need to memorize this, R over N to the NT. This is the formula we're going to use on 76 and 77 that helps us if we know an increment of time. If it's compounded monthly, daily, semi-annually, quarterly, if it's some increment of time you can measure, you use this formula. Then later on, we'll talk about the PERT formula, which is also compound interest, but it's compounding something that's compounded continuously, like the decay of a material or a population growth or something that's at a constant, continuous rate. All right, so again, we're just focusing on this right now. This formula takes some present value or principal start out value, multiplies it by 1 plus the rate divided by how many times it's compounded per year to that number again as the exponent times how many years. That gives you the output of its future value or what it grows to, or I like to think of A as accumulates to. So in number 76, it says find the future value. So we're looking for A. A is the unknown of 3443.61 invested for 11 years. At 4%. So we make our percent into a decimal and it's compounded monthly. It stays monthly, so that's 12 times a year. We use that again here, and our years we said was 11. Now the number one mistake I find in this problem whenever I check student work is putting this in our calculator. If you do your calculator, you say 3443.61 times parentheses. Most of us get that. Parentheses 1 plus 0.04 divided by 12. Parentheses kind of optional around that part, but close your parentheses. Then we raise it to the 12 times 11 must be in a parenthesis as an exponent, or you have to have previously times those together when you raise it to that exponent. If you just raise it to the 12th, you raise this answer to the 12th and then times 11, your calculator knows order of operations. calculations, so it takes this answer to the 12th power, and then takes that total answer 11 times, which is not what it was supposed to be. 11 is supposed to be counted as an exponent. So you must remember to parentheses around your exponent. So type that into your calculator, and you should verify the correct answer as BC. 5, 3, 4, 3, 1, 0, 1. To practice that, make sure you're good at getting that answer. 77 is a little tricky if you don't read the directions carefully. It says find the present value of the future value. The key is it says find the present, which means you're missing the p-value. The p-value is the unknown. The present value is what's given. 4,000 equals unknown p. Compounded at 6% quarterly, which is 4 times a year, for 8 years. So it'll look like that. We'll do all this part. We won't be able to totally do it by multiplication in this time in our calculator. We'll need all of this done, and then 4,000 divided by that to solve. Since the p-value is unknown, we wind up dividing. So let me get an estimate of this answer. This is 1.015 raised to the 32nd power, which is approximately 1.61032. And you want to try not to round too much. And really, you want to try not to erase it from your calculator. If you can get an exact answer, that's even better. The answer will be what you just got on your calculator is divided on each side. And p will equal 4,000 divided by that, which is 2483.97 cents to the nearest. Okay, so if you practice that, make sure you're okay with the calculator skills. Okay, number 78 is an application problem. It has a little bit of essence of the Hertz formula in it. This equation models the growth in the population of a certain rodent at a dump site with its exponential function. So really, I want you to see that the Hertz formula is embedded in this. A sub t is just a fancier way of saying y equals, or the output answer equals. In this case, just regular A for the regular Hertz formula. But the answer to this input-output is 219, which must have been the starting value they found, the starting p value, the present value. E is just part of this formula. It's on your calculator. It has a value. And then the rate is filled in. That's the rate of growth of these rodents. And then time is how many years. So this is really just an application for PERT, exponential growth. And it says t represents the number of years since 1988. And our question is, estimate the population in the year 2000. Well, in the year 2000, that would be 12 years into this function. So the t value is given, so we punch this into our calculator, carefully knowing that's all an exponent, so it needs parentheses around it. So you need to locate your E button on your calculator and raise E to that value, and then times it by 219. Should get 295.62, round to the nearest 100. It said just round to the nearest whole number, which was 296. Okay, 79 is the change of base rule, or actually you wouldn't need to use change of base. There's a way to do this without your calculator. But remember, the meaning of a log means this base raised to what power? The power or the exponent is the answer to a log. The answer to the log is an exponent. So you're looking for the exponent. 8 to what power is that? So you could do it. Just mentally figuring out how many exponents it takes to make that happen. I think we all know 8 squared is 64. But to make it a fraction, it has to be a -2 to get it down the denominator. Now, your calculator has